about to come in a few minutes. Please take a seat. Good evening, everyone. My name is Ben Green. I am the president of the Friends of Syracuse Alumni Association. And I'm glad that to see many faces that I recognize and who I've seen in my life here in Syracuse and outside, as we come together at a moment that you can think to say that may be sad, but this is a celebration of a life, as the Syracuse University family rejoices and celebrates the life of Mr. Lee Keitt, class of 76. And each and everyone who's here, who's met Lee, carries a piece of him with him. He has touched us in so many ways. And I'm glad I have had the opportunity to work with him as we try to bring a piece of coming back together into the digital world with the network. An ongoing process that still is going on. And I'm happy to say that I have accomplished a goal that Lee and I were trying to do since last year. And with all the events that we have here at the Lubin House and other places, and how tech-savvy he and I were, we always wanted to broadcast live from somewhere. And tonight we're doing it. We're broadcasting, streaming live at ustream.com tonight's memorial for the alums and family members who could not make it. And it will be available afterwards when you play it back. So if you're here, make sure before you leave, we do have your email. So we're making history and we're completing a task that he and I strive for. So I'm happy. Also thanks to Jose Vilson, who added his technology into there and we got it to go live. Lee Keitt, class of 76, was a person who, I don't know how he did it, but he managed to touch so many people in such a short time in his life. I want to introduce you to some of our guests that are here tonight who Lee touched out to in many ways. For those of you who don't know, I'm glad to say that in the house tonight, we have his daughter and his son, Carleigh and Charlie. Please stand with their grandson. Also from Program Development, you have Larry Martin. In the back, we have Angela Moraz Patterson from Program Development. From the Mission, we have Dr. Lonnie Morrison. As SU groups and clubs who formed post-graduation in the house, I would say representing, but also a good friend of Lee from the SU Posse, Tony Bennia. If you don't know who the SU Posse are, they are really a lot of the SU alumni who graduated in the 60s, 70s, who paved the way for people like myself. If it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be here. A lot. Then the 80s came, and the Friends of Syracuse were formed, and I managed to graduate and became a part of it, and I still am. And to all the alums who in the 80s, thanks for attending. And then after the 90s came, it came and went, but not with a fierce group of alumni called the SU Black Book, and representing the SU Black Book here is Ebony Dowtin. I think prior to the new millennium, Lansu came together, Jose Vilson, he's in the house. Also from admissions, and Paula Silva, she's here. From the New House School, Max Patino is here. And with that, I want to show you I pulled together some photos of events that happened here in the Lubin House and the life of Lee Keitt, and I just wanted to share that with you. And I hope you can see that this definitely was put together in the Lee Keitt style. Right?
Father to a daughter. proud, and he carried me all the way back home. Recently, he took me to a play that Vanessa Williams was in, and I got to meet Vanessa Williams, so I was happy about that. And probably one of the last things I did with my father was finally cook for him. He didn't realize that I was just like him. And I remember him in the kitchen cooking, but while he was cooking, the radio was blasting, the stereo was blasting, and he's playing his records. And I see a lot of myself in him now. I tell my son elbows off the table because he was big on etiquette. I take my son to real Chinese restaurants because when we were young, he had to explain to us that Chinese food is not fried chicken and barbecue spare ribs. So I do all these things with my children, and I'm realizing there's a lot more in me of him than I thought when I actually got to see a moment to really sit down and think about it.
Wow, what can you say? How can you define the essence of a person's life? Lee was profound. He impacted many people on many levels. And the inventiveness and the ingeniousness that he took upon himself to figure out how to use that technology to reach the higher goal of connecting people together and connecting with people.
Following the footsteps of someone with the drive that you had. Someone who pulled you when you were dragged and picked you up. And I appreciate what he has done for me. And I definitely appreciate the fact that God allowed him to come into my life. And it takes time to heal, you know? But he will always be a part of me. He's that extra drive, that energy that I'll always have. I know this is hard, but now the time I actually become to celebrate his life. I'm asking those to come up and speak and to say a word or two about how it affects your life. But first, I want to open it up to the family, to Carleigh and Charlie.
One thing that sticks out to me is that my father was a lover of all people, and he loved people. And if it wasn't his Syracuse family, then it could have easily been the neighborhood park family where he played handball, or the church family, any circle. My father knew a lot of people, and he got along with everyone. And for this tonight, and his funeral service, goes to show how many people actually loved and cared for my father. And I appreciate everyone coming out tonight, because I know he would have done exactly what you've done tonight. I know him. And he supported as many people as much as he could. Everyone that came to his circle somehow, some way. He had some advice for them. He had a recipe for them. He had a song to play for them. It was something that somebody needed. He had. And I just want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. It's hard for me. I miss him so much. But I really appreciate you, Mr. Green, for putting all of this together, you know. It means a lot to myself, to my son. And I see myself raising him the way my father did. No holds barred. Anyone that told him no, he took that no, and he turned that no into a yes, with a smile, an easy yes. And it was a lot of hard work, and there were a lot of things against him in his time, and that has given me a lot of strength and inspiration, and enough to pass on to anyone that you can do anything. Anything. And I'm gonna miss him a lot. I really am. I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight in honor of him. It's truly an honor, and I appreciate it.
Okay. Son Charles.
Lee Keitt. I called him Dad, but even when I hear the name Lee Keitt, it sends a vibration through my body or a tingle through my body. And any one of you who knew him very well knows that he's not gone. Everything he did for a reason, and he will always be remembered in each and every one of you. And sometimes we might feel sad because he's not there anymore, but we're still happy for the memories that we have with him, for the memories that he made sure he kept and he made sure he recorded, and for the friends that he made sure that he kept around, and for the network that he made to make sure that he kept in touch with everybody. That's how he was. It's still sometimes amazing to me, the people who know him, and even the people who know me through him. A lot of people know me pretty well, though I've never met them. But I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to thank everybody for being who they are, and thank every one of you for being who you were to my father that you were. Because you wouldn't be here right now if he didn't make it a point to keep in touch with everyone. The people who cared about him and the people that he cared about. And I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for everybody for being here. And just always remember, when you feel the pain of him not being around and his loss, keep the good memories. Keep the memories, because they're all good. Keep the memories. And that's what'll keep us going. Thank you.
Ask Mr. Larry Mark for Program Development to come up and say a few words.
Good evening, everybody. I'm proud to be here to represent my office and also Syracuse University and to pay tribute to our fallen brother, Lee Keitt. Mr. Syracuse, I've called Ben Green Mr. Syracuse, but I've got to give Lee Keitt that same title. I also want to extend my condolences to Carleigh, Charles, and his grandson, Alexander Charles. This has been a difficult year for the Syracuse University family, and we've lost a number of alumni in addition to Lee. Helen Holt Williams, member of the class of 1931, passed. She was nearly 100 years old, the oldest alum of Syracuse University. 1931, she graduated from Syracuse. Leon Woods, class of 65. Leon was a businessman. He's from Los Angeles. Many of you remember him from our Coming Back Together reunions. He had a business in South Africa. He was the first one to propose that we travel to South Africa, which we did. He was also a generous contributor to the Our Time Has Come scholarship fund. Richard Bulls, class of 73. Richard Bulls was one of the Syracuse Eight. I'm so glad that Syracuse University recognized those men and their courageous actions. I went to a service, and when I went to a service on his casket, he had the Syracuse manuscript turned to the Syracuse 8 story that we did. The players all standing in the Carrier Dome on the field, and on his lapel, he had a Syracuse 8 pen. Dwayne Walker, another member of the Syracuse State, class of 1980. He passed. When I went to his service in the back of the church, he had the Syracuse 8 citation, he had his letterman's jacket, and he had photos of all of the events that happened that weekend. L. Ross Love passed away, class of 1968. He was a member of the Board of Trustees. At one time, when he was working with Procter & Gamble, he had the largest advertising budget in the world. An African-American graduate from Syracuse University had the largest budget in the world. James Tweet, I wasn't that familiar with James. I met his brother, but he passed, class of 66. I believe you were the one that told me about his passing. Lynn Hooper Jamont, class of 69, she was here for Evelyn's retirement. You remember her pretty lady? She was with a cane and had some difficulties, but yet that didn't stop her from being here helping to celebrate Evelyn's retirement. She was here with her daughter Dara and also Hemsley Jamont. And lastly, Thomas Fleming, class of 72, passed away. From what I understand, he's the first African American to receive a baseball scholarship at Syracuse University. He was a great basketball coach in the Boston area. And yeah, Lee Keitt, great friend, great supporter of my office and all that we do. I'll miss his NSBLN Happy Fridays. It was a great resource, an information center for alumni and friends. His last posting was August the 21st, 2010, a few days after Evelyn's retirement reception. A few days after that, I spoke to both Ben and Lee. And we talked about a number of issues, including coming back together 10. Who would have guessed a few weeks later we'd be attending his funeral? Once again, it reminds us how fragile life is, and tomorrow's not promised to anybody. I don't have to tell you how talented, how innovative, how creative he was. I had many conversations with Angela and Evelyn about Lee. And I would say, how come we're not doing that? We're the pros. They're amateurs. So we were envious of him. I also would joke with Lee and say, if anything ever happens to me, I want you to be questioned first, because I thought he was after my job. We'll always remember Lee. And the other alumni mentioned, and from time to time, a smile will come across my face when I think of them. We owe all of them a debt of gratitude for the many contributions they've made in helping to push Syracuse University forward, in some cases, kicking and screaming. Their many contributions will be part of the Syracuse University legacy. And of course, we're proud to call all of them Syracuse University alumni. The dean of the Newhouse School wanted to be here. Unfortunately, she got her invitation late, so she was unable to. So Max Patino is here representing her. So again, I also want to thank Ben Green for putting this tribute together for him. Thank you.
Yes, we would ask that Max Patino from Newhouse, would you come up and say some few words?
Well, I wasn't really prepared to say anything, but just looking at those images really stirred up a lot of emotions. We actually had a conference call with Ebony and Lee and a few other members a few days before his passing. And I haven't met anybody who bled as orange as me. And this was supposed to be just small talk about the network, which ended up into a four-hour conference call. But passionate, every single minute, passionate about our ideas, passionate about how to bring further attention to the network, further attention to the upcoming students, to the current students. I think, in a way, communications is something that Lee I learned communications in Newhouse, but in a way he taught it again to me, in that he reminded me of this. He reminded me of, you know, saying hello. He reminded me of keeping in contact with my family, my SU family. And that's something that Lee always had an incredible ability to do. And you always welcomed that phone call from him. And it could be in the middle of the day, and you still make time, you know, to listen to him and his ideas. And he will be missed, and we will miss him dearly in Newhouse. We will miss him dearly in Syracuse. And again, we will continue to keep his legacy, his ideas, and his passion alive through all our work.
At this time, I'm going to ask Mr. Tony Bennia to come up and say a few words.
Good evening. Larry, jokingly referred to Lee as the amateur, but in reality, he was truly a master of his craft. He totally embraced the technology and generously shared it with others. But even more impressive than that, Lee was a master of connecting with people on a personal level. Tonight, I ran into Jimmy Cruz. I hadn't seen him for 40 years. So, you know, in the spirit of networking, you know, we reconnected. And Jimmy shared with me an experience that he had that, you know, I think within the past 2 years he had a stroke. And during that time, a ray of sunshine for him in his life at that moment of his duress was a phone call from Lee. Lee called him up at a time when he needed to have it. He didn't prompt it. It was just like a phone call out of the blue, and Lee was there. When I went to Lee's funeral and listened to the testimony of family, friends, neighbors, that theme was consistent straight across the board. Lee would pop up out of nowhere just to say hi. I know in my personal case, I went to Syracuse from 68 to 72 as an undergrad. Lee, I believe, came in 74, graduated in 76. So in that time in Syracuse, we may have passed, but I didn't really get to know him. Okay. That personal relationship didn't really develop until I actually left Syracuse in 79, somewhere around the 80s. During that time, I was freelancing, writing, traveling a lot to the Caribbean, and getting into some desktop publishing, which was an area that Lee was very much interested to in at the time. So we spoke, and I kind of turned him on to some of the desktop publishing techniques and software. So that's when our relationship really began to build. Then, you know, years would pass, a birthday would come up, and I get a phone call out of the blue, and it's Lee. I say, how does he even know when my birthday is? Lee did his homework, but, you know, he was that kind of person who would go the extra yard to find something personal about you and a way of connecting with you. Over and over again, everybody I talk to, you know, it's the same story and the same experience. You know, relating to Syracuse, there's like a continuum of time and space. You know, like Vaughn was there before Vaughn left the year before I came, you know. As I said, in my time from 68 to 72, it was a time of change for Syracuse University as well as the nation in general. It was a very turbulent time. Vietnam, riots, and there's a lot of activity on the Syracuse University campus in terms of upheaval and change. That was my time. God placed me at that moment in time, and that was my purpose, okay, to share those opportunities to have our voices heard at that moment, okay. Lee kind of missed that. He came about 2 years later. But in Syracuse University and all the generations of students who follow, no matter when you're there, what your continuum is, you have your purpose and your moment to express yourself and to contribute to the general pot, to make a mark. Okay. Lee kind of took that ball and ran with it. You know, as I said, he just took the technology. You know, a lot of people could get lost in the sauce with technology, but Lee found a way to personalize it, to make that people connection with it. For him, the bottom line was people, and the technology was a way to get there. Okay. And that was not lost. You know, that was a gift that he had. Carleigh and Charles, you know, I know it's hard to lose someone that you love. You know, if anybody has had the experience, and I'm sure you have, you know, for myself, I lost my mother and father in recent years and a brother. And it's not easy. But as you said, they're always with me. That's the experience that I've had. You know, it's particularly with my parents. Those life lessons, when I would come across those challenging moments in time, the strength that I draw on to get past that is from the root, which is your mother and father. Okay? So, you know, God give you the strength to continue, and just know that Lee hit the bullseye and made his mark in terms of sharing his talent, his love with the rest of us. And we are all deeply in debt.
Now it's time to let Ms. Ebony Dowtin to come and speak on behalf. Share her words.
Good evening. Ben asked me to speak, I guess, to represent SU Black Book, but I wanted to speak because I was a friend of Lee's, and Lee was a friend to me. He was more than a person that I worked and collaborated with. He was truly a friend, truly a big brother. That was my gossip buddy. That was my technology buddy. I say to his children, thank you for sharing him with us. Thank you for sharing him with me. I know you don't know me, but I feel like I know you very well. I saw you at the funeral and I didn't know what quite to say to you, but I do want to say to you, thank you. Your dad was definitely a blessing and irreplaceable. We were rebels without a cause at times. If there was something, a need that we saw that was not met, we made it happen. You know, he knew whatever he needed, I was there for him, and the same. There were many times after our 4 and 5 hour conference calls, after I've texted Lee several times, going, this is getting very long, this is getting very long. On a side note, he would text back, okay, okay, I'm wrapping it up. He would always call me and say, thank you for having my back. And I was like, goes what I was saying, because you always have my back, and you've always had everyone's back. He, like I said, he's irreplaceable. Lee passed on my birthday, and it gives that day new meaning to me because I lost a true friend. And it reminds me how precious life is. You know, I've lost a parent. I know how difficult it is. It's been 11 years since I've lost my mom. But it feels like yesterday. And I would say it's going to get easier, but it really doesn't. But you just have to hold on to the good times, because the good times is what will carry you through the hard times. And I have a lot of good times with Lee. And I know he's touched everyone in this room in some kind of way, whether you know it or not. Whether it was with Happy Friday, whether it was with 100 calls. Because if Lee was going to contact you, he was going to contact you. I mean, I would sometimes have 5 missed calls, and I'd be like, Lee, I'm going to get to you just a moment. He was like, well, I knew it was okay. I was never upset. I knew, we would connect eventually. And that was my friend, and I'm going to miss him. And there's no one I've met that has such dedication to Syracuse without an initial reward. He didn't care what he was going to get out of it. He wanted to see it benefit everyone. And like I said, he saw a need that wasn't met. He found a way to make it happen. I don't care if it was with technology, if it was with a phone call, whatever. We were going to make it happen. And we were going to still make it happen for him, for all to come after us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ebony. Now I ask that Mr. Jose Vilson please come up and share your words.
Hi, everyone. So I didn't, I came here thinking about all the things I could say about Lee, and the biggest thing I remember is when I first graduated from Syracuse in 2004. I helped found the Latino Alumni Network, Syracuse University, and along with Ben, along with Abado, along with Angela, he was the main recorder for everything. As a matter of fact, I think about CBT, the last CBT, I was on that panel, and I look back at that presentation, and Ebony's laughing because she knows what I might say here. One of his last things that he said at that panel was, and I quote, "I have 54 things that I want to share with everybody here, but I'm only going to share 15. And he was just like that. Like, he would have all these things that he wants to share with everybody. But in the interest of time, he said, I only got 15 to share with all of y'all. And Joe would look at me, I would look at him, and I'd be like, you got to let it ride. You got to let it go. You got to let it go. Because he just wanted to give. He wanted to give. And it was actually the first meeting I remember ever being shared by recording. No one had ever done that before he did it. The same goes with this. And, when I heard that Lee and Ben wanted to do this sort of thing, I was like, come on, I can help you do this. So I would do it. And I also remember, even when there was like 7 people there for our meetings, for the announcing meetings, he was one of them. And he would, videotape us, do all the recordings. And then maybe 2 or 3 weeks later, I get a phone call maybe at 11:59 p.m. And I'm a teacher, by the way, so like the next morning, I got to be up. He goes, and he's like, let me call. And I go, hello. Yeah, I uploaded your video, man. It looks real good. It's so good. I can't believe it. I just want to let you know that I shared this with everybody. It's going to be on Happy Friday tomorrow, and it's really good. And I said, all right, yeah, that's cool. Thank you. And like, I'd wake up the next morning, and of course, I'd see it on Google, I'd see it all over the place, I'd be like, Lee, you did it again. He shared it with everybody. And when I was young, I was like, wow, he has this energy of too much. I guess like, wow, it's so overwhelming. And then, but like, as I grew older, I was like, there's something about this guy that says, I want to share, and I really don't care what anybody else thinks. It's about what everybody needs to come with. And you better come with whatever I come with, or you need to keep running. You need to keep going with me. He just shared, and no one can keep up with him. He's gonna be missed. And I thank you. Thank you everybody for sharing him.
Now, as we videotape, get a shot of the audience there, we can share that with other people. I'm going to ask Ms. Shemeka Peters to come up. Now, I just want to preface this, and she'll tell you her part. I remember meeting you as a freshman,
And then when she graduated, you know, Lee and I saw her, and she was like, what do I say to the alumni? And, you know, I was like, just go. Come on, girl. They want to meet you. I'm at CBT, and she went, you know, meet. But she'll tell you about her meeting with Lee, and then all of a sudden, boom, she's out there doing stuff. Like she's a professional. And not like she was a professional. I actually thought she was a professional. I'm like, well, what happened? But I'll let her tell her story, and I see how Lee affected her. So, Ms. Shemeka Peters.
I would just like to thank Ben for just giving me the opportunity to just share what Lee Keitt meant to me as a mentor. I remember the first day I met Lee Keitt, and I was coming back from CBT on the Greyhound bus, and Lee was actually sitting in front of me. And I was sitting in the back of him, but I have not officially met him yet. So I'm talking on the phone exactly from the start of the bus ride all the way to New York. And as you know, that's a long trip. So at the end, when we get to the terminal, Lee Keitt introduced himself to me. He said, I've never heard anyone talk on the cell phone for that long. I have a lot to say. And he introduced himself to me. And looking back, I didn't know how important that CBT meeting was. That's when Ben, Lee Keitt, and so many other alumni got together and really thought about the importance of having the network together. I look up to Lee Keitt. He had the standard for networking. He will call us. He worked a lot with Jose. He worked a lot with myself. And he said, Shemeka, how do I get connected with the new Millennium Group? How do you, you know, they don't come out to any of the events. And I said, Lee, you got to get on Facebook. Everyone is on Facebook. And then as soon as you mentioned anything to him, he would just grab hold of it, and he just transformed Facebook. Everyone was connected. Everyone knew what was happening. He was at every single event. Everywhere you go, you would see Lee Keitt. You could always count on him, or count on him being there. And he wasn't only a person who stayed within the box. He started coming to the fashion alumni events, the accounting alumni events. He started coming not only to the Newhouse events, but every single major under Syracuse, he was there. He was at every single event. He was a really big supporter. And just as a mentor, anytime, you know, Ben mentioned it earlier, I didn't even know the power of networking. He really instilled that in the upcoming or new freshman students who are coming into Syracuse. He mentored them. He talked to them. I was so shy. I didn't know what to do. And he just really taught us how to just go out there and make connections with alumni. And it's so easy for us just to connect with the people that we graduate with. But Lee Keitt showed us the importance of knowing people from the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s. And it was just a situation where, you know, he really, really had a heart for reaching out to the young people. And I always will be thankful. It's a hard shoe, as Ben mentioned, it's a hard shoe to fill. But, you know, I'm committed definitely to helping out, reaching with the new Millennium students. I know Jose is reaching out with the Lansoon. Also, Joel is also working with the Lansoon. And we're just committed. I know we can't fill the shoes that, you know, Lee Keitt and also Ben, friends of Syracuse, but we're going to try, and we just pray that you guys continue to mentor us so that we could continue the legacy of what Lee started a few years ago for us. And I just want to say, you know, to his family, you have a great father. He really reached out, had a heart for young people, and really seeing them grow into the potential of what it is that they can do.
Thank you.